mentioned at the beginning that at Mass, the church is really wanting to take us to four places. She wants to take us to the temple in Jerusalem. So there is this sacrificial element to the Mass. She is taking us to the upper room because this is where Jesus is going to maintain the idea of Passover and sacrifice, but he is going to introduce new elements to the sacrifice, and that is the elements of bread and wine. The third place she is taking us to at Mass is Calvary, where Jesus actually lays down in sacrifice upon the cross as the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And finally, she wants to have a vision of heaven at Mass, based on some of the images that we see in the book of Revelation. I'm not going to talk about all four of those places, but the one I want to draw out a little bit is the second one, and that is what takes place in the upper room. I hope, whether you are Catholic or not, I hope you know that as Catholics, we believe that at the words of consecration, the elements of bread and wine become the body and blood of Christ. This is not a symbol to us in a common speaking sort of way. It's not a metaphor for us. We actually believe, this is our faith, that this is the body and blood, soul and divinity of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I am always amazed. Sometimes I'll talk to Catholics who have had some sort of reversion in their life, you know, so maybe they were born and raised Catholic and they just kind of, you know, just mindlessly went through CCD or their religious training, and then they fall away from their faith entirely, but then the Holy Spirit reawakens their life and they have this reversion. They come back into the church with full force and full enthusiasm, and they'll say to me, "Father, no one has ever told me that that's what we as Catholics believe, that at the consecration, bread and wine become the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ." Every time I hear that, I think to myself, how could you not have heard that? So, I mean, I tend to think that, oh, they heard it, it just didn't sink into them. The reality of those words didn't sink into them. So I don't want anyone leaving this Mass today, whether you're Catholic or not, without knowing that simple fact. That's what happens at Mass, and that's why it's a mystery. Remember that Jewish sense of the altar. Things from the altar go to heaven, but also things from heaven come down to the altar. And the moment when that happens is when the priest does what's called the epiclesis. He'll put both of his hands over the elements of bread and wine, and that accompanying prayer, asking the Holy Spirit to fill this with the life Jesus Christ. Another significant point, just kind of for your own information, we believe that what we receive is the resurrected and glorified body and blood of Jesus Christ. So the reason why this becomes important is because every now and then somebody will say, you know, you'll go to Mass and only the body will be distributed for Holy Communion and not the precious blood. And so then you might be wondering, well, did we receive the full communion? Well, the answer is yes, because in the smallest fragment of that bread become body, and in the smallest drop of that wine become blood, is the fullness of the body and blood of Jesus Christ, because we receive the resurrected body, not the crucified body. So that's just something for your own background information. But anyway, this is what happens at Mass. Body and blood of Christ is made present to us. Now, my question is, how exactly does this happen? The church, the great saints, the mystics, the philosophers of our faith, they have wrestled with this great mystery for centuries, and we will continue to wrestle with this mystery for centuries, trying to figure it out. The scholastics, during the time of St. Thomas Aquinas, they talk about transubstantiation, which is a beautiful philosophical way to explain what happens at the Mass. How the substance becomes a new substance. But ultimately what it comes down to is our faith. We believe this because this is what Jesus said at the upper room. In the sixth chapter of the Gospel of John, Jesus goes into his long dialogue, the Bread of Life discourse, and he tells the crowd that if they want to go to heaven, they need to consume his body and his blood. Well, as you can imagine, people are horrified by this. Are you talking about cannibalism? I can't imagine violating every kosher law there would be. They're horrified by this, and Jesus doesn't back down. He insists, "You must consume my body and blood." People eventually are so horrified by this that they walk away from him entirely. He doesn't back down. "You must consume my body and blood." So you can imagine if you were one of the apostles leaving that situation, "Lord, we're not going to leave you because where else do we go for answers, but we don't really understand this teaching." Now in the upper room, maybe things are made a little clearer. He holds up the bread and says, "This is my body." He holds up the wine and says, "This is my blood." The Jews are familiar with this. They've been doing it in the Passover for centuries. Body and blood. Now, here's what's helpful for me, because ultimately this is a matter of faith. I don't know how the world was brought into existence. It's a question for science to wrestle with. It's a question for theologians and philosophers to wrestle with. I don't know how something can be created out of nothing. Clearly, it is. It's not hard for me to believe that the motion behind all the motion, behind all the motion in our material world, is the cause of a prime mover. And it's not hard for me to believe that that is God. So when this voice says, "Let there be light," and there is light, it is what it is. So when I look at that upper room, and I see Jesus holding up the bread, the same voice that said, "Let there be light," and there was light, is the same voice that said, "This is my body. This is my blood." This is definitely a great mystery, but the mysteries of our faith, like the Holy Trinity, the Incarnation, these mysteries are not for us to solve, but they're ultimately for us to live. As something happens on the altar, life from heaven comes down, and if we put our life the altar and consecrate our concerns and our disappointments and our worries and our fears to him, then just as bread and wine can be transformed into the body and blood of Christ, then so too can our lives be transformed and be given not just new life,